we moving as one. I'm so proud of who I become. You might think I'm taking some lumps. Only if we talking about some. Yeah.
What's good, everybody? This is Blake Ferrell back again with podcast number 6 of Blackboard Stories. Last week on the show, I got the opportunity to talk to Cortland Butler from our own Webster tennis team. We got to talk about how he has been able to overcome so many adversities in his life and still been able to keep positive and just have a driven attitude. Talking to him actually made me realize that we may not be able to see what other people are going through and the obstacles that they have in order to get to their success. Thinking about the fact that we should respect everyone's hustle and everyone's grind, no matter where they are and what position they are in life. Feel free to go check that out on Webster Athletics page on their website and also streaming on Webster's Athletics Facebook and Instagram page. This week, I have the opportunity to sit down with someone who I've watched grow as a person and a basketball player throughout the years. He grew alongside me and close friends and family members, actually here from St. Louis, and is now playing on Webster's University basketball team as a junior guard, Cody Parks. But I'm not going to call you by your legal name. We're going to call you CP.
Yeah, everybody call me CP. You know, it's a nickname that I had since probably since I was like in kindergarten, and it just stuck ever since then. So everybody around campus called me CP, so you guys can go ahead and do the same. It's all good.
So CP, man, what's going on? How you been?
I've been good, man. You know, just working hard in the classroom and on the court. I know it's a little bit different, you know, with everything that's going on right now, but, you know, I've adjusted to it, so I've been doing good.
Yeah, you speak about just the difference of what's going on and stuff like that. How's practice been going?
We've been grinding hard. You know, our practice, it's a little bit different from, I'm pretty sure, like in the past, you know, when you were playing, you guys had a veteran team with pretty much a lot of the same familiar faces. This year, not having that many seniors, like, you know, going back to last season, and a lot of new players. It's a lot more teaching going on this year since, you know, it's a new team to get adjusted to. But, you know, I like it so far, and we've been working hard to get prepared for the season. So
that's good. So with COVID and the new rules going on, I heard that you guys had to go through 3 different types of phases. Mm-hmm. So could you just tell me what those phases were and kind of how you felt about each individual phase?
Okay, so phase 1 or week 1. Started September 1st, I believe. October 1st. And we spent basically that week and a half doing nothing but conditioning. And we can only do it at a limited time frame versus, you know, how everything was before then. So 1 week of 1 week and a half of conditioning. Then the second week, we finally was able to do stuff basketball related. So we got to, you know, work on ball handling, you know, combination drills, attacking the basket, basically just skill set stuff, but still, like, no competition against each other, no 4-on-4, 3-on-3, or 5-on-5 type drills. Mm-hmm. And then went through, like, 2 weeks of that, and then recently, about 3 weeks ago, we finally were able to actually have actual basketball practices to prepare us, you know, for the upcoming season. So each phase, you know, was a lot of hard work, especially the conditioning, because, of course, a lot of us probably haven't, you know, been able to be in that position where we're taking care of our bodies, you know, for a season in such a long time with COVID.
And then right.
Once after that, I think all of us adjusted to it well. And, you know, the skills part and the practice part, everybody's starting to find a rhythm now. So I think we're on the right track.
So you're actually a transfer. How has it been coming to a new school and a new community?
I mean, I've always wanted to come here. This has been, like, my dream school since my last year of high school. I committed early, and I knew, like, once I committed, I felt like this would be the best fit for me, not only basketball-wise, and I love the relationship I have with Coach Munch and the coaching staff. They treated me like family since day one. but also academically, because they have my major. And just the setting of the campus and the environment is what I need. You know, it's not like a big, big city or a big area, but, you know, it's going to keep me focused on just, you know, what I'm here to do, which is, you know, get an education and try to improve to be the best basketball player that I can be. So
that's what's up, man. I'm glad you're enjoying it. So I have this new section on my podcast, kind of new. I've been basically asking my guests a couple of questions, getting to know you questions, and then they've been answering them however they feel. Okay. So I'm going to do the same with you. So the first question is, what are your top three restaurants / fast food places that you like to eat?
Top three, I would say Panda Express, Waffle House, and Chick-fil-A.
Okay, I like those Waffle House and Chick-fil-A restaurants as well. We both go to those often, so yeah.
We know how that goes.
My next question is, who are your top five artists that you've been listening to right now?
As of right now, I would say Lil Baby, number one. Of course, I feel like he got cheated out of album of the year, but it's all good. NBA Youngboy, Moneybagg Yo, that's three. I say Meek Mill, that's four. And I would probably say, number five, Polo G.
Okay, I can definitely vibe to some of your playlists. Yeah. You got them in there. Who are three people that have inspired you during your lifetime?
One, I said my parents. They inspired me. I wouldn't even say basketball, like from the basketball aspect, but just, you know, their work ethic and, you know, they came from tough backgrounds too. So to see how they've been able to get through life, you know, still teaching me, you know, what it takes to be, you know, a young man and to be successful, even if it's not, you know, coming from the best backgrounds. You know, I appreciate them for that. So I would say one, my parents, you know, that's all in one for me. Two, I would probably just say the mentors and leaders that I've had in school and basketball. I mean, it's a long list of them. I can't really say for sure, but I've always had good leaders and people point me in the right direction. So I'll probably say, you know, some of my teachers and coaches that I've had in my life, you know, they've been really good.
Mm-hmm.
And I follow kind of like, you know, the way that they go through life. Three, I think it's more just, besides like close friends and family, including you, I think it's really just, you know, like an internal thing. The confidence that I have in myself to achieve my dreams is, you know, something that motivates me. So I wouldn't even say it's like three particular people,
because
I've been blessed with a lot of good people in my life, you know, to help me be successful. So I think it's more just, more of a general thing. And then really just comes down to me having faith in myself, which has allowed me to, you know, get to where I am now. So
that's a good answer. So my next question is, what are your top five Jordans?
Oh, this should be easy. Give me the Jordan 11s. Give me the Jordan 1s, the 4s. The 13, since that's the brand, the type that I have the most.
Mm-hmm.
And give me the 3s.
I knew you was about to throw the 3s in there. I knew you was about to throw the 3s in there.
So,
I was waiting on it. I sure was
ones,
waiting on
3s
it.
And 1s are so, like, when you think of Jordans, like, the 1s and the 3s.
Yeah, classics.
Classic.
Yeah, so, classics. Yeah. Then my last question is, who do you think you model your game after?
It's so hard to model my game after certain guys that I watch, but, you know, from somebody's game that I try to pick parts and pieces of, not just their style of play, but, like, their mentality and their approach to the game is Jimmy Butler. You know, what I like about Jimmy is that Jimmy doesn't have to be effective by scoring every game, even though he is a bucket. You know, he can score when he really, really needs to. But what I like about Jimmy is he's always consistent in his effort, and that's what I try to do. So it's like, I think if I've gotten older, I don't really focus on trying to score that much. I think my goal is, you know, do the other things that may not always be impressive to everybody or show up on the stat sheet. So that's like defense, you know, dialing on 4 for loose balls, you know, causing 5-second calls, taking charges, you know, doing stuff like that. That's important to me, especially if I've gotten older, because those little things is what helps you, you know, get looked at by colleges, which, you know, you got to be able to do that type of stuff, because everybody can't be a scorer. So that's, and I try to translate it to my game now here in practice. So it's like a lot of times, it's not that I'm not aggressive to score, but it's like I just let it come. But defense, energy, like that's something you got to always have, even if you, you know, not necessarily my offensive threat. So.
Yeah. Well, I know we talk about all the time how everybody always wants to be the man.
Yeah.
But it's kind of like how Doc Rivers always tells his players on how they just need to be the best in their role.
Yeah.
And I think that's just a great quote and just like a something that we could just take towards life in general.
Yeah, like that's something that I would probably tell like younger players that's like coming up trying to figure out what it may take or that's getting recruited to play college basketball at any level. Just if anything else, you know, try to get better at the little things that help your team win. Like, because you may end up on a team where they got plenty of scores already. So try to do something different and do things that, you know, it may not, you may not think is important, but when you actually give effort into it, you know, you'll realize those type of things can help you become a better player and help your team win. So.
For sure. So you kind of talked to me about a little bit about how you got to Webster and your journey here.
Mm-hmm.
But can you kind of allude more on that and how you did get to Webster and like how you figured out it was your dream school? And
I mean, well, I've been playing basketball since I was probably like 4 years old, so probably before I even started like elementary or grade school. I tried other sports along the way, but basketball, I adapted to it, you know, so much better and easier than a lot of other sports, because, you know, running up and down and shooting, you know, playing defense, and the crowd is a little bit, you know, more energetic because they're more close up on you than maybe like football, because farther away, crowds are bigger, but basketball, you feel the energy like more closer. You know, it's been my dream to play college basketball, you know, since the beginning, and I knew I loved the game for sure with a passion probably when I was like, when I started middle school, because I realized how close I was, you know, to starting high school, and I watched a lot of the older guys that I looked up to that I play against at the rec center, and when I would watch them play games and just seeing how intense the crowd was and how much better they were, and seeing some of those guys make it to college, even in, you know, some tough environments, you know, I was like, man, I can't wait to do that one day, you know. And when I got to high school, I went to McClure North, and that's one of the tougher schools, you know, in the suburban North Conference. You know, play high-level competition, you know, pretty much every single year, and we're playing the best teams in St. Louis, out of state. So, you know, I knew playing against tough competition in high school would help me for college. And then
you even came to the camps here at Webster University while you was in high school, right?
So I came the summer going into my senior year. Coach Bunch and Coach Staff reached out to me and, you know, asked if I basically invited me to come to the Webster camp. And I had went to a couple other, like, small, like, D3 NAIA schools. But it was just something about here that just – it's like just from the start, from day one. I don't know if it was just the environment or the campus or the coaches showing love. I think it was just a combination of that. And the crazy thing about it, I had never even thought about even, you know, coming here until I got that, you know, the opportunity. And then, you know, even being here from St. Louis, like, I come from a different side. So when I hear about schools out here, I don't really know much about them. The colleges or the high school. So, you know, like when I came here, it was just like a whole different world. It was a lot more peaceful, you know, see all the big houses and how everything is constructed together.
Yeah, man. So tell me about that. Like, tell me about the difference between coming from North County to Webster Groves. Like, I know a lot of people don't get to see that side of St. Louis, especially people who live out here. So kind of allude to that more and talk about that.
I mean, I tell people all the time, you know, it's even tougher actually on the city side than it is on the county side. But, you know, it's just crazy just how St. Louis is. You know, it's not nearly the same environment. You know, I'm really saying sometimes you may not feel as comfortable just living, you know, in certain parts of the county or in the city versus, you know, areas in between like this. And this is what I needed. Some, you know, more peaceful, you know, less distractions, somewhere I can go where I just focus on school and basketball.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the type of person I am. I mean, I like to, you know, it's not wrong with big cities or big areas or bigger schools, but it's like my personality, it don't really fit that.
Right.
Because I feel like if I get too drawn into it, you know, I get distracted on what my goal.
I get caught up and distracted, yeah.
So I feel like my personality fits this type of area in this school. So it's completely different from, you know, the city or the county side where it's, you know, it can't even put into words just how tough it is, you know, depending on where you come from.
So right.
Even get to college, so.
Right. And that's kind of talking about different obstacles that we all have to face. But just coming from that type of background is just another hurdle that you have to jump in order to get to where you want to be in life and just stay successful. And a lot of people don't realize that when you come from places like that, it's hard to get out of places like those. You know what I'm saying? Because, like you said, there's a lot of distractions and a lot of temptations that, you know what I'm saying, draw you into that life and will suck you into that life and keep you there.
Yeah.
So I think it's important that we not only get out of that chain or break that chain, but we also tell the younger generation below us, you know what I'm saying, that there's more out there that can be done, and there's just more out there in general, and there's more to life than, you know what I'm saying, what other young kids are falling into.
Yeah, like another like a little advice for like, you know, younger kids out there. St. Louis, I'll say this, and I tell people this, you know, a couple guys on the team ask me sometimes, like, what's it like living here in certain sides, because they hear about the stories and they know just, you know, how dangerous this city can be in other areas outside of here. And I would say, you know, yeah, it's dangerous, you know, in certain areas, but I always say this, it's easier here to get into trouble than it is to get out. So the best thing to do is to find a craft or something that you like to do and, you know, make something out of it, you know, whether it's building your own brand or business, whether it's sports, whether it's music, arts and crafts, like find something, you know, that can keep you away from all of that. And you can use it, you know, later on in life to actually make a career out of it. I mean, we got great examples of it. Like, look at Jason Tatum, look at Bradley Beal. You know, we got other guys that's coming up, you know. And they don't, like I said, it don't have to just be sports, but just find something special that, you know, that you can build with in life. So you won't have to worry about, you know, trying to be in the streets or,
right,
you know, stuff like that. So.
So coming from where you come from, what do you think motivates you?
I think sometimes, like I said, seeing people who made it out of this city, and then also learning from people who, you know, had the opportunity that was right on the brink, and they had themselves in the right position, but they started listening to the wrong people,
mm-hmm.
or they couldn't, you know, they couldn't take that neighborhood personality out of them, you know, just for a split second to put them over the top.
Right.
So it's like I use, you know, like I said, I use people, for example, like Jason Tatum, Bradley Beal, you know, other people in music here. You know, I use those type of people as examples of people who made it out. And then I also look at, like I said, I look at people, you know, that I've known or that I've seen in the past that they was right there. They have an opportunity to do something big, whether it's with sports or whether it was with music, but they just made bad decisions. And I use that, you know, as examples of what to do, what not to do, learn from it, and then, you know, try to expand on it so I won't make those same mistakes. So even though St. Louis, you know, it is tough here and it's a lot of craziness goes on, there are some good examples out there. And I think people here should definitely, you know, especially younger people who still, you know, have a lot of time, you know, definitely think about that.
Yeah, they should definitely think about that and definitely look to those people. So, coming from St. Louis basketball players have a stereotype of being gritty and tough and just really energetic. Do you think any of that influences your playing style, or do you see that in your playing style?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I may not be as vocal about it, but, like, it's in my game because, like I said before, especially, you know, the competition I played against in high, just in high school, you know, we played some tough comp. The biggest thing that you will notice is how intense it is. You got to play here. Like, if you soft, it's gonna show. You're gonna get exposed. Mm-hmm. So, like, you know, don't be soft. You know, if you want to play basketball, you know, at least at the high school level here. And like you said, a lot of players here, like, they got that dog in them. Like, they may show it in different ways, but you ain't gonna find too many people. They'll be like a kid from St. Louis playing at any college. They'll be like, oh, he's soft. He ain't got no game. Like, we got some dogs here.
I agree. I think St. Louis definitely breeds some dogs, especially in basketball and many other sports, football. All different sports, really. With this year being the crazy year that it has been, what knowledge has this year brought you?
Man, I think it's made me appreciate the little things in life a lot more. I'm going to say that I never appreciated, but it was eye-opening. I mean, just look at all the crazy stuff, you know, that's going on. I mean, we started off the year, you know, by losing Kobe Bryant. I mean, that hurt. But what I learned from that was, like, it don't matter how much money you have, who you are, I mean, you know, who you idolize, who you look up to, like, they're human, too. And their life can be going just like that, you know, unexpectedly. And then, you know, that hurt. I was hurt. I still think about it every day. And then 2 months later, you know, COVID hits. And then it puts everybody's life was affected by it. Rich people, middle class, you know, poor.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody had to adjust to how they make money, how they provide for their family, education, you know, even people in professional sports. You know, they had to go through a phase of, you know, how can they get themselves, you know, through this, and then when they get back, are they still going to be even, you know, half of what they used to be as an athlete? So I think this year is, you know, it's been a lot of learning experiences that taught me the importance of, you know, life.
Mm-hmm.
More like the small things more than anything.
So, yeah, especially like you said, with the small things, like, I think this year we've all been a little bit more grateful for the people who do the small things, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, I think when people really realize was, like, when I never did this, but there's a lot of people who, like, before this, they would always talk about people who have, like, small jobs or, you know, people who work at, like, Walmart or gas stations and stuff like that. But it's like those places became essential, you know, when the pandemic hit, especially between, like, March and, like, the start of June, because there really wasn't much else to do or anything else open. So I think we understood, like, we can't underestimate anything or any job or any career path that anybody has, because this whole thing has affected everybody. So
yeah, my last question to you, sir, is what legacy do you want to leave here at Webster University?
I want to be known as somebody that, you know, who was a hard worker and respectful of everybody around him, in the classroom, on the court. I don't really want to be known by anything, like, too major or anything like that, but just somebody who, you know, had the same amount of respect for himself as he did for others, and, you know, appreciative of everybody that, you know, showed love and support while I was here. And, you know, I'm halfway there, pretty much being finished, but, you know, I still have, you know, a legacy that I want to leave behind, you know, both as a person and as a basketball player. So,
for sure. Yeah. Well, once again, I want to thank you, CP, for coming on the show. You know, you like a brother to me, man. Yeah. It's always love just getting able to chop it up with you. So appreciate you coming out.
You know, it's all love. Appreciate you.
Best of luck to you and your team. Hopefully you guys are able to have a season and do y'all thing. For sure. Well, that's all, folks. Remember, if you keep a positive attitude about your life, contribute to a world of peace, unity, and positivity, you're going to be cool. All right? Cool. This your boy, Blake Ferrell, with Blake's Blackboard Stories, brought to you by Webster Athletics and Galaxy Radio, signing off.
You know what I'm saying? We in the building, we case for a billion. Ain't nobody playing. Live every word that I'm rapping. Say I lost 90 bricks and it happened. You probably wouldn't believe everything that you're seeing right now if it wasn't live action.